Good morning and welcome to our webinar on cross-border data flows for business growth in China, upfront frontline updates. We're so glad to have each of you joining us today as we explore the opportunities and challenges within this dynamic landscape. As one of the world's most robust economies, China holds an immense pool of consumer and HR data that companies of all sizes are leveraging to fuel their growth strategies. However, exporting this data from China presents its unique challenges due to a complex legal framework that is evolving at a rapid pace. This webinar is designed to arm you with the knowledge to harness the power of data and also accelerate your growth within China while protecting your business from a major compliance pitfalls. I'm Hannah Giotto, a privacy and technology attorney with Baker Donaldson. As an attorney trained in both the United States and China, I have spent over a decade assisting companies in crafting their global compliance strategies. I'm honored to have our guest, special guest speaker, Anna Xuan, joining us live from Beijing, China. Annie is a privacy cybersecurity attorney with Jen Law Firm. With a deep background in privacy and data protection, Annie has guided US-based multinational companies through the complexities of Chinese privacy and cybersecurity laws, including the industry leaders in automobile, online travel, and pharmaceutical sectors. Last but not least, I have my dear colleague, Vivian Peden, joining us from Baker Donaldson's Atlanta office. Vivian advises clients on a variety of data privacy and security issues under both international and domestic laws. She is known for her practical approach to solve complex privacy matters, thanks to her significant experience in both legal and consulting. So we'll spend a 1 hour together this morning. First, Vivian will give us an overview of China's privacy and cybersecurity landscape. Next, Annie will provide actionable strategies to ensure us to ensure data originating from China can be exported in compliance with these complex legal regulations. And finally, I will lead a few case studies demonstrating the practical applications of these compliance strategies in scenarios, hypo scenarios. And then we'll open the floor for a Q&A section. During the webinar, there might be pop-up boxes that you need to click through to make sure we check the COE credits for you. So without further ado, Vivian, over to you.
Hi, good morning. My name is Vivian Fang Peden. I am on a counsel at Baker Donaldson's Atlanta office. I'm so honored to meet with you this morning and talk about the China Data Protection Framework. So why are we here? With all these privacy laws coming in, there was not a day that passed that you don't hear about a new privacy laws and new decisions popping up in EU, Brazil, United States, and of course, China. And it's just in adding additional wrinkles to your broad patchwork of data privacy. In the recent years, China has emerged as a forefront force in data protection. But why are we here? How are we gonna tell our stakeholder within the corporate America or wherever you are that we need to invest resources to this emerging trend? Think about it as a citizen. Every company is a corporate citizen in your jurisdiction. If you look at your company's overall health, what is the most important assets of your organizations? Is it your reputation in the marketplace? Or is it the numbers on your balance sheets? But after these two top priorities, the third most important asset is your data that you carefully curated throughout the globe during your global growth in all sorts of markets. And currently, whether your presence in the EU or in the United States, in Brazil, and in China, you start hearing about these words on data transfer, data localizations. And that definitely adds additional complexity, even for company with a very high data compliance maturity levels that you've been building, putting investing hard work since 2016. And we're here to help you to analyze, adjust, and supplement your data privacy compliance maturity levels to align with the goal of the China privacy laws. The China privacy laws consist of three top pillars, which is cybersecurity laws effective 2017, data security laws effective 2021, and after all, personal information protection laws that everyone hailed as the new GDPR of the East. With the three pillars of China privacy and security laws, we feel like the data is locked, we're secured. And then global organizations are thinking, well, what am I going to do with the data that I have been collected over the years that probably can inform about my financial health, my market, and my future growth strategies? Very quickly talk about the difference between the three laws, and we will also have Annie do a deeper dive. Back in 2017, cybersecurity laws introduced this this landmark definition called a critical information infrastructure organizations. And in 2021, there is data security laws that reminds organizations that you need to categorize your data based on the sensitivity. Last but not the least, you got a PIPL that apparently is a Asian version of the GDPRs. If we look at the next slide, you will realize that the China privacy laws holds a lot of similarities to the GDPRs. And it imposes a very high fines of all the way up to 5% of your turnovers, while GDPR is only 4%. If that number isn't something that alarms you, we all heard about the Meta decisions yesterday where they're facing a $1.2 billion penalties. And that's really drawing attention from both the C-suite, all compliance officers to really take a hard look at their data mapping, data strategies, and the efforts that they need to invest in data compliance. What China data privacy laws differs from other jurisdictions is that it not only impose monetary penalties for organizations, it also impose liabilities for individuals in charge. So far, we have not seen individuals actually get a fine from the big government, but the number, as you can see on this slide, can range between a few thousand dollars to a few hundred thousand dollars. And possibly for those individuals who are making final decisions on data transfer, data security, they will be prohibited from serving in a role like a CPO. While currently the geopolitical situations makes a lot of companies and countries thinking about what are we going to do with our relationship with China in terms of data, are we going to decoupling, decentralizing? There are many talks about how we're going to leverage the current situation to protect our interests. But let's take a step back and see who is the person in charge. For our US audience, a lot of time we think we're very, very different from the mystic kingdom of the Middle Kingdom in the East. But in reality, there's a lot of similarities. Just like the federal government in China, we have the Cyberspace Administration of China. And that's similar to the Federal Trade Commissions and Federal Communication Commissions, the FTC and the FCC in the United States, as the enforcements of the data privacy and security laws in China. And then we have the provincial level cybersecurity authorities. You can kind of say it's similar to the attorney generals who will be enforcing the state level privacy laws that are popping up. Currently, we have 10 that will go into effect this year and next year. But the primary difference, and which Annie might chime in down the road to tell the difference, is that in the United States, the state attorney generals only enforcing their state laws. The California with the CPPA will just enforce their privacy laws, and Virginia attorney general is going to enforce theirs. They don't overlap. They don't necessarily answer to a higher authority. In China, we don't have states, we have provinces. You got the Guangdong provinces where Huawei and the big companies are located. You also have independent municipalities such as Shanghai and Beijing and Chongqing. And these provinces or municipalities are actually answer to the central government. So they are enforcing the laws and they answer to the CAC in terms of guidelines. Last but not the least, like the United States, we have a lot of sectorial data privacy regulations, such as the HIPAA, the GILBA, the FERPA, and those of you who has making the investments in SIP certification, you have heard about all of that. And those regulations applies in healthcare, finance, education, etc. In China, there are also a number of laws in this space, and that's why just like our U.S. counterparts in the United States who are trying to juggle between the federal and state, the Chinese practitioners like Annie's are doing the hard work of trying to reconcile all different kinds of guidelines, measures, federal, central laws, local laws to help you develop and implement your strategy. I want to really quickly talk about the basic concepts before I turn the floor to my colleagues. What is data border, cross-border data transfer? A lot of us, if we look at a traditional sense of thinking, I have to affirmatively take the efforts of transferring a data. Maybe I should download my data in my thumb drive and hop on the plane. That probably is a transfer. But in the data privacy world, we're probably looking at both an active transfer and a passive transfer. Not only we need to worry about data transfer if we're affirmatively transferring the data outside of the mainland China, we also have to look at a very common scenario where we will make our database available to vendors or other entities located outside of China. So as you can imagine, back in 2020 and 2021, the Schrems decisions and all the EU guidelines are talk about what is the cross-border data transfer, when do we need to implement the standard contractual clause. That rules are very similar in the China data privacy framework, that if you're remotely accessing data, in some use cases, you are also considered a data transfer. There's a number of rules that I just mentioned that we will defer to our local council to help us guide with all these running regulations, measures, guidelines, interpretations, and it's a very evolving landscape. So before I turn my floors to my colleagues, I want to quickly talk about what is the takeaway? What are we going to do with all these privacy laws coming in from Brazil and China? And are we going to completely change our process just to adapt the local privacy laws? Are we going to do a centralized data privacy process, or are we going to localize it? Or should we do a hybrid? My thought is that China, and when it comes to data privacy compliance, can really sweetly fall into the seven frameworks that you probably have been familiar with since day one when the GDPR comes out. You will hear about the data inventory where you have to do a data mapping to know what kind of data that you have in your global organizations. And you take a hard look at the regulations on whether certain data needs to be stored locally. And of course, the topic of the hour, which is cross-border data transfer, in what circumstances can we transfer, what assessment we need to complete before we can have some of the data that we collect as a result of our business, both personal and business. We also have the consent, which a lot of people find it very painful to get a consent from the individuals. And China privacy law do have various requests and requirements when it comes to whether cross-border data transfer or processing, where you might use a consent as a legal basis, or in some cases, when you're collecting minors' data, you do need a affirmative consent. And in China, that age threshold is 14. We have DPAs. For those of you who are in the privacy domains, where none of us would say we have, there's not a day go by we don't talk about DPA, data processing addenda, that is currently making our master services agreement longer and bigger and more complex. And China certainly are not going to leave this very crowded field by introducing China Standard Contractual Clause that recently just got translated into English. And we are going to quickly discuss these topics in our future slides. Last but not the least, China, just like other jurisdictions around the world, are very sensitive about data protection. So incidents response and risk and impact assessments will form the foundation of the China data privacy compliance framework, as well as your measures across your global privacy framework. Hopefully that gives you a good foundation about what we're doing, why we're doing it, and how we can reconcile our current framework with the China data privacy. So without further ado, I'm going to turn my floor to my expert, Annie Xue, who is hailed all the way from Beijing, China, where my family's originally from, and she's an internationally known expert in this space. And without further ado, Annie, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Vivian. Thank you very much for laying the background, the foundation. Good morning from Beijing. Hello, everyone. I'm so happy to be here and share my experience and insights from the China laws perspective. You know, just the, like the case of GDPR, which has, you know, adequacy list and multiple safeguards for cross-border data transfer. So according to Article 38 of PIPL, China's Personal Information Protection Law, China also provides at least the three data exporting mechanisms. We call it mechanism, not safeguards, which are first, you know, security assessment led by China's Cyber Space Administration of China. In short, we just call it CAC, a very powerful government agency. You know, it will come out and do the security review when a company hits certain thresholds, which I will talk in more detail later on. And secondly, we have a security certification. And thirdly, China's standard contractual clauses. In the future, China may also come up with some other mechanisms, such as adequacy list or binding corporate rules, just like the GDPR, because China has learned quite a lot from the GDPR when it tried to build up its own, you know, data regulatory regime. But there are still quite some uncertainties in this regard at this point. So today, our focus would be security assessment, security certification, and SCC, China's SCC. So here, this slide gives it a kind of like a bird view about how to do a cross-border data transfer when it comes to personally identifiable information, PII. So we can start from the simple part. If you look at the right hand, the two boxes. So if your organization in China falls into the category of CIIO, or your controller processing data exceeding certain threshold described or prescribed by the government agencies, you have to, by default, localize your data, store your data within the territory of mainland China. And whenever you want to send over your data overseas, or your overseas headquarters or subsidiaries want to have access to China stored data, you have to go through the CAC-led security assessment. It's quite a complex procedure. We can talk more in details later. But if you are just a regular data processor, you may or may not have multiple options. But in any case, probably you all have to go through, you know, to first secure a separate consent if you decide to use consent as your lawful basis. But please do remember, in China, in our PIPL, also like in GDPR, our law provides multiple lawful bases. So apart from consent, informed consent, we also provide, you know, like contracting or compliance with legal liabilities or responding to certain emergencies, such already publicly disclosed information. So all those could constitute lawful basis for your firsthand data gathering. And after you gather the data, and before you transfer the data overseas, you have to do the DPIA, and you have to put appropriate technical or managerial measures to ensure that your data will be safe before, during, and after it is transferred overseas. When it comes to the data exporting mechanisms, if you hit some threshold, provided for by the government agencies, so you will have to, you have no option. You have to go through the security assessment, which will be conducted by the CAC and some other agencies. But if, fortunately, you do not hit the thresholds, you have at least two options. One is certification, and another one is ICC. We will also talk in more details later, one by one. Let's look at the next page. Okay, here it talks about, you know, when you have to, you know, you have you cannot opt out. You have to go through the CAC lab security assessment whenever, you know, first of all, your organization in China falls into the category of CIIO, which so far still remains a myth. You know, according to our classic definition, the CII normally refers to the information systems that are so critical to our national security, public interest. So whenever it gets destructed, destroyed, or compromised, you know, it will not only hurt your organization, your customers, your employees' data, but also China's national security and public interest. And normally, you know, business operators operating in the sectors highlighted in red, there is higher likelihood, you know, for them to fall into the CII category. But it may or may not be the case. For example, some smaller, minor information systems used by the business operators in these sectors, they may not be a CII because it's so minor, so not important. But for some very super important IT systems, even they are used not by the business operators in the named sectors, but still these information systems may still be defined or regarded by the government agencies as a CII. So basically, it's not up to us, business operators, but up to the government agencies to decide whether a information system would fall into the category of CII. So it remains to, it belongs to the final say of the government agencies, not our business operators. But of course, our practitioners, lawyers, we can help you to do a preliminary self-assessment to have a, you know, basic sense about how likely your system would fall into this special category. And for other thresholds to have to go through the security assessment is that if a company that will export data, normally non-personal data, but still they're so important, not just important to your company, but also to China's public interest and national security, we call it important data. And in some cases, if the personal information, the volume is so large, for example, it may exceed 1 million individuals' personal data. So as a whole, this kind of data may also be characterized as important data. So I would say in most cases, important data is not personal data. But in certain cases, in certain rare cases, even PII may be regarded as important data. And some other thresholds also include if you are a company, even though you are not a CII and you are not processing important data, but still you are processing individuals' personal information, and there are so many of them. It even exceeds 1 million individuals per PII, personal information. Still, if you export data overseas, you have to go through security assessment. The other two thresholds is that, you know, if from January 1st of previous year, you know, in total, you export 100K individuals, regular personal information, or 10K, more than 10K sensitive personal information, you will also have to make a filing with the CAC and apply for the security assessment. That's a first mechanism. And here is a flow chart about how to do the security assessment. So basically, you have to do a self-risk assessment. It's basically a preparation for you to, you know, even you yourself, you have to have a clear sense whether when you export data, important data and personal information overseas, and whether there might be some risks popping up after the transfer. Only you yourself are confident, okay, it's totally fine. At the US headquarters, our data will be properly protected and will not be, you know, accessed by other third parties or even the US government agencies without due explanations or due causes. So you, then you can go on with filing for the data exporting security review with provincial CAC. So please remember that the provincial CAC, they're not the authority with the power to review your document. They're just the window person, but somehow they have the preliminary judgment power to make a decision about whether your filing documents or materials, they're good, they're complete, they're accurate, or even the situations, data exporting situations you describe in your filing document really, you know, fall into the scenarios that call for the security review. They may tell you, hey, it does not need security review, or you're not sure, you ask whether our data exporting scenario should go through the security review. They may tell you, yes, it is. And some other scenarios, related scenarios, may also have to go through this whole exercise. They somehow have this kind of preliminary power, which will materially impact your data processing activities. And if the provincial CAC is happy about your filing documents, they will transfer the documents to the central CAC, which has a real power and authorization to review the documents. But the CAC is not the only agency to do the review activity. It will do the job in collaboration with some other government agencies and specialized institutions associated with the government. And after the review, normally there will be two outcomes. One is that you pass it, so good luck. And for this kind of result, normally it will stay, it will remain valid for 2 years. But if your application is blocked, which basically means that you have to stop your data transfer, And upon receiving the written notice, you have 15 business days to apply for reassessment. But the reassessment result will be the final result. Of course, you can still challenge it through administrative review or administrative litigation. And in total, it will take you about 2 to 3 months. Because, you know, for the whole exercise, there's no stop clock mechanism. So if the agencies, they're not happy about your filing or your document supplementation, but since they still have the time pressure, they may just persuade you or let you to drop the application and make the refiling, so the clock can recalculate. That's a flow chart. And next is another data exporting mechanism, which is called the security certification. It's something like the certification under the GDPR. So there are basically two applicable scenarios. One is that, you know, if you're a multinational company and you have China subsidiaries, or maybe some Chinese headquartered companies, they have overseas subsidiaries. So for the whole group, they may choose to secure the security certification. If they do not satisfy the threshold, that will have to go through, security assessment. The second scenario is that there are some offshore business operators, actually they do not have any business presence in China, but still they may still get caught by the PIPL, because like the GDPR and the CCPA, PIPL also has extraterritorial jurisdiction, which may, you know, catch some overseas business operators. You know, in this case, it's not very convenient for you to do the SEC, because there will be nobody from, you know, China signing the SEC with you. So more practically, a certification is a more practical option for you. So basically, SEC and the security certification, they are mutually substitutable. You have to do some preparation to pass the security certification. It's easy to say, but still quite a lot of, you know, a real job to do. First, you also have to do the DPIA. So again, you yourself have to be competent in the first place. And you have to reach a binding agreement about the compliance obligation allocations. It could be agreement or some other legal documents between the China data sending party and the overseas data receiving party. And you have to set up some common principles to be followed by all parties. It's something like the BCR, binding corporate rule. So I would say China's security certification is something like a hybrid of GDPR, SEC, and the BCR. And again, you have to apply some technical and managerial measures to ensure during the whole process of data transfer, your data is safe. And as of now, the certificating body in China, you know, not just any organizations or companies can do this kind of certification job. Only those that got license from the government can do the job. So as of now, there are only one or two government-associated institutions that have this license. And according to our knowledge, there's no publicly available information shows that any company has already passed the certification mechanism. Next is about the China Standard Contractual Clause. So here you can see the timeline for China's SEC. And actually, the SEC mechanism will officially take effect on June the 1st, but there are still 6 months grace period. So you have some preparation time to make sure that all the internal protocols, policies that can endorse and back up your SEC will be put in place before November 1st, if you decide to use SEC as a mechanism. Next page talks about some, very important points about China's SEC. So please remember that, given that China provides the SEC, it's an official version. So it's set within the SEC that you know, the governing law would be Chinese law. It's not optional, it's mandatory. So you cannot choose to use like the US or the UK law as a governing law. And in terms of the dispute resolution, again, you cannot choose a US arbitration forum or US court as a forum to solve the dispute. And the ICC actually assigned some arbitration forums that you can choose. You do not have quite some options, or you have to go to the Chinese courts. Again, you have to, on the right hand, you can see you need to do the self-assessment, sign the ICC, and very importantly, 10 days after the effective date of the signed ICC, you have to make a filing with the provincial CAC. It's not a review procedure, but just the filing. They do not review it, but you have to, you know, sort of like notify the provincial CAC about your signed ICC. And together with it, you also have to submit your self-assessment report. That's a package for you to make the filing with the provincial CEC about the standard contractual clauses. With that, I'm going to wrap up my part and give the floor to my colleague, Hannah.
Thank you very much, Annie. And as you can see, there are a lot of moving parts in this area, so we'd like to put this into a context, and we created several hypos. So let's take a look at them and see if we can collaboratively find the best solution for those companies to transfer their data out of China. So number one, Company A's Chinese division, known as Company A China, is based in Zhejiang, China. This division is comprised of 50 dedicated employees. The parent company, Company A, is headquartered in the United States and operates within the consumer goods industry with a focus on clothing and footwear sectors. In order to streamline their operations, Company A China intends to transfer the personal information of its 50 employees to its data centers in Illinois, United States, for purposes of storage and analysis and processing. Company A upholds a robust and contemporary privacy compliance program to ensure compliance with notable data protection regulations, such as the GDPR in Europe and the CCPA in the United States. In its commitment to safeguarding data, Company A employs the EU-UK standard contractual clauses for all data transfers originating from the European Union and the United Kingdom. So, first question, what is the best data exporting mechanism under China's privacy and cybersecurity framework to transfer Company A China's employee data to the United States Illinois data centers? So, as you can see on the right side of the screen, we're putting up the slides for four options for cross-border data transfers under the China framework again. CAC security assessment, security certification, and standard contractual clauses and other conditions. So first, think of the type of data we're transferring. It's employee data. So personal data, and we're assuming that there's no important data here. So Company A does not process important data that will affect the national securities. And data volume, there are 50 employees. So company A is still under the CAC security assessment threshold. So in this case, it's likely that we don't need a CAC security assessment for company A to transfer data out of China to the United States. So then we have two options left. It's either security certification or implementing China's standard contractual clauses. So so between those two clauses and options, how should we choose? So I think we'll need to look at the business objectives and risk tolerance, whether the business wants to be exposed to the Chinese logo regulators and to what extent they want to be audited. And we should also consider the existing compliance efforts here. So in the fact pattern, we mentioned that this company A globally has a pretty good sophisticated compliance program. So they already implemented standard contractual clauses in other jurisdictions. And as Annie mentioned earlier, the security certification will need to apply through government certificated licensed institutions, and there are only one or two licensed certificate institutions around China. And currently, there's no data that any company has actually passed a security certification. So it seems to us that this mechanism might be pretty new. So considering the fact that company A has already have experience implementing standard contractual clauses globally, so I think the option will come down to implementing China's standard contractual clauses here in China for Chinese data. So then here's a question. Since we already have EU-UK standard contractual clauses, can we just use those templates and apply it to China? So the answer here is no, because China has its own officially approved and template form of standard contractual clauses. The official one is in Chinese, but the English version translation is available. And as Annie mentioned earlier, those the China standard contractual clauses, the clauses, very similar to the EU standard contractual clauses, cannot be negotiated by parties, cannot be changed. But the parties can always add on more obligations in the appendix of the China's standard contractual clauses. So the next question is how to implement the China standard contractual clauses for company A. So on the left side of the screen, here's the slides again about the China standard contractual clauses. And the process will be, first, we need to conduct a self-assessment. Then the data exporter and the data importer will need to sign the China standard contractual clauses. And last but not least, within 10 days from the effective date of the China standard contractual clauses, we need to submit the documents to local regulators for records. So this is the first case, and let's move on to the next case. The next one, company B, a multinational corporation registered in Delaware, operates an influential e-commerce platform. Despite the absence of any physical infrastructure or data centers within China, the platform has successfully captured the Chinese market. It enables Chinese consumers to independently browse, select, and order products with ease. Company B's e-commerce platform is hosted on the United States instances of Microsoft Azure. owing to its significant reach, the company manages a considerable volume of data, transferring the personal information of over 1 million individuals to the United States on an annual basis. During interactions with the platform, various user data is collected. This includes information gathered by cookies and data pertaining to user preferences. More critically, when users interact on the platform, they share personal details such as usernames, addresses, and bank account information. This information is subsequently transmitted to company B's US base, ensuring a seamless and personalized shopping experience. So in this case, first, it's very clear that this company B is over the threshold. So as a reminder, here's the slide on what types of companies are required to pass a security assessment by CAC. So critical information infrastructure operators, CIOs, and other covered companies who pass the assessment thresholds. So this company is an e-commerce company, so it's not, it's likely, it's likely it's not in the industry of the critical information infrastructures. But however, the fact pattern says the company processes 1 million individuals over 1 million individuals' personal information annually. So this is over the threshold, and which will trigger CAC mandated security assessment. And on the right side of the screen, here's the flow chart on CAC security assessment. Again, as you can see, the process is not easy, and you will require boots on the ground to help you prepare the documents and submit to the local regulators and complete the filings. And then the CAC will issue a notice on whether you pass or you block, and the result will be valid for about for 2 years. And the entire process will take about 2 to 3 months to complete. So there are already many CIOs and companies that passes the over the thresholds that are already filing the CAC security assessment. So it's not too late to do that. But if you satisfy those requirements, you should act fast. So here's our last case. Company C, a prominent organization based in Beijing, China, is a parent corporation to a subsidiary, Company C, United States, located in California. Renowned for its software as a service, customer relationship management product, Company C has multiple data centers strategically located within China, supporting a comprehensive database of customer interactions and behaviors. In a bid to optimize this product and contribute to ongoing research and development efforts, Company C intends to transfer data originating from its Chinese operations to Company C, United States. This cross-border data transfer is crucial for interacting the insights gleaned from the vast Chinese market into their global R&D initiatives. Recognizing the need to maintain the highest standards of data protection, particularly concerning the personal information of Chinese individuals, Company C is seeking to obtain a security certification from the China Cybersecurity Review Technology and Certification Center, CCRC. In this pattern, Company C already told us what they want to do. They want to apply for a security certification, and it's and the certification will be from the CCRC, which is one of the institutions that already received the government license to conduct those security certifications. So as a reminder, if this company is under CAC security assessment threshold, and also then you will have two options, security certification and standard contractual clauses. So in this fact pattern, they choose to apply for the security certification because they want to showcase their compliance programs in China as a successful software service CRM program company. So how should they do that? They will need to conduct DPIA, reach a binding agreement regarding compliance and obligation allocation, set up common principles to be followed by all parties, execute technical and managerial measures to ensure security. And one thing we want to point out is that if they want to apply for security certification, both the data importer and also the data exporter will need to, those two entities will need to obtain security certifications. So in this Company C's case, Company C China and Company C United States both need to be audited and apply for this security certification. So with this, we have 7 minutes left. Let's open the floor up for questions. So first question we have, if a data subject in China directly provides their personal information to your company in the US, is that a cross-border transfer even though the US company never held the data in China? Annie or Vivian, do you want to chime in? Annie?
Yeah. So I would say it will depend. It depends. So it will depend on whether the overseas, for example, US company falls into the jurisdiction of PIPL. If just the one time data transfer from the data subject to located in China and to the United States, I would say no. It does not, the US company does not fall into the jurisdiction of China's PIPL, and therefore the Chinese data cross-border data transfer regime will not apply. But on the contrary, if the US company, it specifically targets the Chinese market and monitor the online behaviors of the Chinese citizens or the individuals living in China, even though it may not be a Chinese citizen, then I would say the overseas, the US companies will be caught by the PIPL. And if the China located data subject, you know, the deep reason, the root reason about why the data subject sent over its data to the US company, probably because, you know, it's just want to buy some stuff from the US company, like through e-commerce, online shopping, then I would say this cross-border data transfer will have to comply with the Chinese cross-border data transfer regulatory regime. And so the US companies have to do the assessment about which mechanism apply to it. Is it about the CAC mandated security review or the SEC or the certification? It will have to do assessment.
Thank you very much, Annie. Next question we have, could you please talk through the process of obtaining consent, especially for an onward transfer under the standard contractual clauses? Which party, personal information handler, or overseas recipient is responsible for obtaining consent from the data subject, and how does that process work? So the consent, I'll hand the floor to Annie and Vivian. I think I'll just lay the foundation. The consent is one of the legal bases under Chinese privacy and security laws. So if you rely on consent to process personal information, then to do the cross-border data transfer, you need to obtain separate individual consents from individuals. So this is a complex process, and sometimes for e-commerce companies, they can hardly even find all those individuals to obtain their consent. So in a HR scenario, maybe this is easier to address because let's think of this case study one. We have 50 employees, so maybe one of the thing we can do is that we have all those 50 employees to sign written consent to say they consent their data can be transferred to the United States.
And I want to quickly chime in about getting employee consent. I'm sure those of you who has managed a workforce, you know, annually you do a lot of these trainings and, you know, a reminder of our company's values. Hey, here is an updated employee handbook and consent forms. And those as are generally combined in those flow of paperwork. Quite frankly, we all signed it, even as an attorney. At my firm, I just go through the flows and say yes to this and say yes to that. So employee is generally not the hardest threshold. In terms of a B2C, Annie can chime in, and we talked about it in this space, is where, you know, occasionally you got those, you know, emails and say, hey, we have updated our terms and conditions. We've updated our privacy policies. And using that mechanism, but there are also an elements of, you know, whether that's a freely given, you know, whether that's really constitute a true consent. So I'd love to hear about Annie's perspective on how we can demonstrate that this is an affirmative consent versus, you know, people just click through without knowing what they say yes to.
Yeah, actually, I would have to use depends again, because even if it's an onward transfer, if it's already foreseeable at the very beginning, you know, when you first time collect the consent or secure some other lawful basis, if you have already disclosed the onward transfer, because it happens a lot, right? It's not just that, you know, the data goes to the United States and it's over, it's period. It could be further transferred to the European Union or some other places where you have subsidiaries or have business presences. So anyhow, if it's already foreseeable when you first time collect the consent, as long as you have already fully disclosed, very clearly disclosed it to the subject, you can get the consent even for the onward transfer when you first time collect the consent. That's one point. If after the data is transferred overseas, like to the United States, then something happened and you have to do the onward transfer after you already secured some lawful basis, then it could be either the China data exporter or the US data importer, you know, you reach out to the data subject and get the consent. You can allocate this obligation, this job within your SCC, but normally it's a China domiciled data exporter that will be eventually held accountable by the government agencies in case of any violations, because it's much easier for the agency to catch the business operators within the territory of China. That's my point.
Thank you. We're already on the top of the hour, but let's take one last question. Could you talk about how companies are doing data inventories and data maps of what China data they have? Is this something that's typically done in an automated and ongoing way as opposed to a manual process? So in the United States, under GDPR and CCPA, sometimes we do like those manual questionnaires that can take a lot of time for companies to fill out and a lot of like attorneys billable hours. And there are also like data inventory, data maps vendors available that US-based companies can choose. So are there those kind of vendors in China?
I would say yes. But it seems that their services and products are not very popular, probably because it's not very mature. So right now, in many of our data compliance projects, we still use a table, Excel sheet, you know, to do the data mapping and the inventory.
So are you saying that, I'm sure a lot of these attendees on this call, they used to those providers such as OneTrust, such as TrustArc, and all these service providers that you see pops up on the cookie banners, and these providers provide a lot of tools for them to do the global data mapping. Would you recommend working in the same workflows that they've been used to the last 6 years, or because of the complexity of China privacy laws that we need to kind of take a different route?
Yeah, in terms of the workflow, yes, I definitely recommend the mature, sophisticated workflow. But I really do not recommend, you know, simply choosing this like OneTrust for the China subsidiaries or business operators, because it's very tricky. Whenever you use an offshore service provider, you will be facing the very tough job of cross-border data transfer, because they have to, in the first place, access your data to do the data inventory and data mapping. So in that case, you will have to transfer the data to the overseas vendors. So just more work.
Thank you very much. And this has been a very productive conversation, and really appreciate our special guest, Annie Xu, joining us from Beijing. And hope everybody have a good day. Thank you.
Thank you. It's been a great honor.
Thank you very much.
Have a great day. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.